Now, a month or so ago, we did a programme on welfare benefits, pointing out that £100 million goes unclaimed each year in post offices and that people don't know what benefits they're entitled to, because there are so many of them. We explained what benefits you could get on the programme. Well, today we're going to hear from a Social Security manager, two MPs and a Social Services director on how they think the system could be improved. Joan firstly asked Tom White, Director of Social Services in Coventry, whether he thought the benefit system was abused.
I think we must recognise that there is some abuse. There are some scroungers who are prepared to use all the devices available to get more than they're entitled to. But they're a very, very small proportion. Our experience shows that the vast majority of people are entitled to the benefits that we receive. And the real problem in the country isn't the problem of people having benefits to which they're not entitled, but a very large number not getting benefits to which they are entitled.
There are various reasons for this. Sometimes they've had a bad experience and have been turned down and don't want to go again. Sometimes, as in the case of, for example, rate rebates or rent rebates, they're frightened of their landlord or they're frightened of officialdom at the town hall.
Would you endorse that view?
I think one of the greatest advances that can be made is to make the social security offices up and down the country rather more human places.
It's possible, you know, that at the end of a rather harrowing day, one of the counter clerks might not be on their best behaviour, for want of a better expression, momentarily. But by and large, our staff are carefully selected, carefully trained, and there's no doubt about it, within my 20-odd years' experience of administering supplementary benefits, they treat people with compassion.
One elderly lady said that she didn't like to ask for anything. How do you cope with that?
I think it's not so much a case of us coping with it, but the lady herself coping with it. Why doesn't she like asking?
Well, isn't it for you to go to her and try and solve that, rather than, you know, just ask the question, why doesn't she?
Well, up to a point, we do this. I'm assuming that that this lady you're referring to is already in receipt of supplementary benefit.
Yes.
We have a regular contact with people who are in receipt of an allowance from our department, either by personal visit to their homes or by postal contact, and our staff are trained to keep a weather eye open for any particular needs that may be existing. And admittedly, and why not, the initiative must often come from our side. We know full well that there is a sense of reserve, a sense of shyness on the part of people who have a certain pride and a certain independence. And we've got to more than meet them halfway to overcome that and give them their full entitlement.
How many people do you have in your area that can go out and visit people?
On the supplementary benefit side, we have a regular visiting staff of about 7 or 8.
And how large is your area?
We cover the western two-thirds of the London borough of Wandsworth, which is a pretty big patch of territory.
How many people would that be?
Oh, 200,000 maybe.
7 people for 200,000 potential.
Well, that's the potential size of the market, but that's probably an overstatement. The actual number of people, or the number of claimants that we have receiving supplementary benefit from this office, is something rather less than 7,000.
I would like very much to see a central point in every town and every borough, perhaps two. Somewhere which was immediately obvious to the citizen that this was where he could go for help. Whether it was to find out whether he was getting the right social security benefit, to perhaps query his family allowances, even to find out whether he could get a plumber.
But one must remember the range of advice that's needed. Legal advice, advice on divorce, advice on alimony, advice on rents, rates, advice on social security, advice on housing. And this does mean that there should be not just one centre, I think Joe would agree with me, but probably several in any large London borough today.
If we are going to have a continuation of means-tested benefits, we must find some way whereby when someone applies for one benefit, a check can be made to see if they're likely to be entitled to others, some kind of passport scheme. And this we're working on in Coventry. There was an experiment recently in Edinburgh University which showed the feasibility of this pattern. And we're now working on that in Coventry. It does seem to us possible that if we were able to link with the computer an application form for one benefit, so when someone applied for a rent rebate, we could check to see if they were entitled to supplementary benefit, to free school meals and all the rest of it. It would be a tremendous asset to those who are applying for benefits in the city.
Would you like all of Wandsworth's benefits to be under one roof?
In an ideal world, yes, it's the ideal solution. But we're far from being in an ideal world.
Right. Would it be possible for you to supply, say, one form for people to fill in, and from that you could then tell them what benefits they're eligible for?
I think probably we could progress towards something like this. But there's no doubt about it, some considerable administrative problems would arise. People are terribly sensitive, you know, about certain things. They're terribly sensitive, and rightly so, about the confidentiality, the degree of confidentiality with which we handle their affairs in money matters. Probably less so in other spheres.
Mm.
So we've got to be jolly careful what information we'd be prepared to divulge to other agencies.
Joe Richardson, the one-purpose form?
Oh, I'm very much in favour of it. And, in fact, in terms of local authority benefits, this is being applied by some local authorities. They're all allowed to do it, but, unfortunately, they don't all take advantage of it. But I know one, in fact, in the borough where I live, in Hammersmith. They've recently introduced a one-purpose assessment form, so that you go along to apply for one thing and immediately you're asked all the questions that there are and you're never asked again. And they are then able to say to you, ah, yes, but you are entitled to a home help as well. Did you know that? Or you are entitled to concessionary fares or to free fares. Did you know that? And so on. And I think we should work very fast towards this kind of one-purpose form.
I think that this must come about because it makes it so much easier. Because our social security system is complex and is going to get more complicated. There's no easy answer to this. If you're going to help the poor and underprivileged and the deprived, you have to, in my view, have selective benefits, and that means testing a person's means and their right to benefit. And you must make that as simple and as human and as straightforward as possible.
All right, then what about the means test? Do you feel that it is the best way of getting help to the people who really need it?
I am in favour, basically, of universality. I would, as far as it is possible, and it isn't always possible with every kind of benefit, I would give it to everybody and then take back what is surplus in the form of taxation, a clawback, as it's called. I think that this is the fairest way to do it. The benefits are there of right. They're not a charity to be applied for. And if you then give them as of right, and then you take back the surplus cash in some other way, which is by way of tax, I think this is the fairest way of doing it.
Well, Joe Richardson said it was the fairest way of helping the underprivileged, and I'm not at all sure that she's right. It's certainly the most expensive way, universal benefits, because everybody gets it, the rich and the poor, whether they need it or not. If you're going to help those who need help most, you've got to be selective, and that does mean some sort of means test. But I am all in favour of making the means test more human.
Do you think that means-tested benefits are the best way of getting money to the poor?
Selectively administered and means-tested benefits have served the purpose well in the past, and I think they're destined to remain with us for a little longer in the future too.
But that means you're satisfied with the situation as it is?
By and large, yes.
Well, I'd like to see benefits as of right. There are a number of benefits which are, of course, available as of right: old age pension, sickness benefit, injury benefit, family allowances. Now, if we were able to increase the amounts of those benefits, and in particular that last one, family allowances, to the levels that they are on the continent, for example, very large numbers of people who today have to depend on discretionary payments wouldn't have to do so. Now, I think that's fair enough to say, but if, in the present state of the economic circumstances of the nation, the government can't afford to do that, I think we've got at least the responsibility to see that those people who are entitled to discretionary benefits should get them, and lots more effort must be made to see that they're knowledgeable about their entitlements.
And we hope our programme a month ago did just that. But if you are still in doubt about what benefits you might be entitled to, don't be afraid to ask what your rights are at your local social security office. And if you don't get a good answer there, go to your Citizens Advice Bureau or your law centre in the area you live in.